So welcome, everybody, to Accessibility of Library Spaces and Services, Thinking Beyond Automatic Door Openers. We are so glad to have you here today. With me is Jolene from DPI as well. She works on the special education team as an education consultant, and I'm going to let her say hi so you could hear her voice and let your ears tuned to the different speakers today.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jolene Troya, and I'm an education consultant here at the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction. And my role is to serve as the consultant for Universal Design for Learning, as well as assistive technology.
Great. Thank you so much, Jolene. And I'm really just excited to collaborate here with other DPI staff so that we can get a broader understanding of things that really are affecting us, whether we're working libraries or schools or other community settings. So thank you, Jolene, for being part of today's presentation. So for those of you, you probably heard about this webinar from the various announcements went out. And this is the description that was included in the announcement, and it's rather lengthy, so I just want to point out the main things that we're going to be looking at today. Like Jolene mentioned, we are really focusing on a framework called Universal Design for Learning, or UDL, and we're going to take that framework and apply it to public libraries and emphasize how a range of library users might access and engage with library spaces and services. So it's really kind of a broad idea of how to kind of look at things from a bigger picture or perhaps just a different vantage. So today's conversation is going to be informative in terms of learning about Universal Design for Learning, since that's not something that's often talked about in public libraries. But also we will be kind of explorative and just thinking about how some of these ideas or tenets of UDL might apply to public libraries or the work that happens in the public library system. So that's what we're going to be looking at for the next bit of time here. And essentially today's takeaway is thinking about these things and again how they might apply to the setting in which you work. And with the main idea of as emphasized in the word universal, making your library truly welcoming to all people. That's kind of the angle we're going at today, just some ideas and thoughts to kind of get us in that moving in that direction. And so I also want to pause here as we kind of know what we're heading into and just remind you that at your bottom of your screen is where you can mute your audio if you're joining us by telephone to make sure that we're not hearing your lunch or any other phone conversations that might happen. As you're joining us today, so just remember that. And also for folks who are on computer audio, you might want to check that your mic is off in case you're snacking on some Doritos or something like that. So with that said, let's look a little bit more at what we're going to talk about. So we're going to start with a brief audience poll. And so we'll use a feature of Blackboard Collaborate for that. And then I'm going to walk through a basic review of special populations and special services as they are described and appear in our libraries. And then Jolene's going to take over and give us an overview of UDL. And then we're going to move into a conversation about UDL and public libraries. And then turn back to some discussion and certainly answer any questions or comments that come up from folks. And we've got an active participant out there who's already found the feature I want to talk about. Thanks for that smiley face. I'm going to just take that as recognition that you are in support of the agenda today. But let me show you how that feature works with the poll. Because rather than a standard poll where you might select A, B, C, or D, I'd like to find out where folks are on a range. And so this is an example of maybe what is your favorite flower. And so we've got some different choices here. And those plus marks are kind of showing where people are at. And so I'm going to put up a poll in a minute where you can show on this range where you are feeling. And so if you're wondering where that check mark came or that happy face, you will see a narrow bar, kind of bridging your participant and chat window, and that's the whiteboard tools. And the second tool on there, and you can play, don't feel shy right now, the second tool kind of looks like a star or a sun or a compass rose. That one, if you press it, you will be able to choose an icon, a pointer finger, a check mark, a smiley face, or that compass star. So why don't everybody try that on the whiteboard tool, that long bar, the second from the top, just click it, and then it's like a sticker, and you can stick it on the screen. Great. Great. I've seen a lot of people do this. And you can play with that. You can change the sticker, what you want it to be. And so I'm going to just describe the directions one more time in case you're trying to figure it out. So it's on the whiteboard toolbar, the narrow bar with different squares on it, second from the top, which is the compass or the sun or the star shape. Click it or pull it out to get more choices, and that's where you can make a sticker. Awesome. Okay, let go for a second. I'm going to advance the screen. And this is the question I'd like you to respond to. Just one sticker. Which statement best describes your library's approach to accessibility? And so you can see the choices on there from a nervous approach, neutral, reactive, or proactive approach. You might be right on one of those, or you might be somewhere in the middle. So I'd just like you to, again, get your sticker and put it above on that bar so we can kind of see where you're at. You can only put one choice out there. So if you are unsure, just click it somewhere else and your initial mark will go away. So I'll give you a minute to do that. And when there's no more movement, we can kind of see where folks feel that they're at. Great. I'm really liking to see these variations of stickers as well as where folks are at on the spectrum. Okay, I think we'll pause here, and you, as well as we, can see where folks feel that they're at today. We definitely have different ends of the spectrum, folks who are kind of feeling maybe a little uncomfortable, that they're perhaps out of compliance, not really doing as much as they can, and also on the other end, a feeling that they are taking a lot of efforts and measures to make their library accessible in a range of ways for users. And then, kind of unsurprisingly, we have folks in the middle, kind of trying to figure it out, doing some things, you know, responsively, and others maybe less so. And then I'd say the majority of marks are somewhere along the reactive. You know, once they're aware of something, then picking a response. So that's really great. I appreciate your honest responses on here. And again, we can't see who voted for what, so that is a bit of privacy with this kind of polling method. And I think this is just a good place to take our conversation, because some of the elements of Universal Design for Learning are more proactive and just kind of having the mindset of thinking of all sorts of folks and all different ways to offer a welcoming message in your space and services, as well as thinking about different ways to engage and access things perhaps beyond the ways that we tend to think of reactively. So with that, let's keep going. And I'm going to turn off the whiteboard feature. So sorry about that, but no more stickers for a while. But thanks for your participation with that feature. So again, we just want to put out this disclaimer for our conversation today that this is a judgment-free zone. We are not pointing fingers. This is not a session about should and shouldn't, what should be happening or what you're not doing right or what any of those kinds of statements. This is really a webinar that's about getting more information and exploring some different frameworks and ideas. And, of course, learning from each other about either sticky areas or issues or places where we might be able to help each other. So that's kind of what today is all about. And as the session description kind of put out there, we want to be thinking outside of the box. Often In my work, especially as a special services consultant in thinking about accessibility, it's often most visible or recognizable or familiar to many library folks who are thinking about serving the public of just thinking about accessibility in terms of providing accommodations for physical disabilities. And that's certainly an incredibly important role for libraries, and I think the one that probably has the most recognizable compliance concerns related to the Americans with Disabilities Act. But there are certainly more things that have developed since that incredible piece of that incredible law. So we're going to just be doing some more exploring outside of the box, and these are some of the ways that we're going to be trying to think about this. Again, from thinking about different learning styles and how people might want to get information or share things, different ways that they might engage with content, whether it's a program or a service. Also, just thinking about ways that we might have connections with individual patrons or patrons with each other. That's a feature of this kind of accessibility. And as Artie stated, thinking about spaces and services. And then again, at the most broad level, is just thinking about a welcoming atmosphere and how that is communicated, whether it's coming through the front library door or it's just the message or the reputation of your library in the community. Those are things that we're thinking about today. So concrete and abstract. So like I said in the agenda, I want to just review a few things about what we're talking about on the public library development team in terms of special populations and special services. And one question I get a lot from both library folks as well as other people, even here at DPI, is like, well, what does that exactly mean, youth and special services? I know youth services, but what's special services? And the idea of, well, special, aren't we all special? What does that really mean? How does that adjective describe something that's unique if we're all unique. So this is a term, and again, terms only have, they're essentially limited in some way. But what we're talking about with special is that, you know, it's kind of become this all-purpose adjective that often generalizes exceptionality. And so what is recommended, which can be hard to do when you're not exactly sure who you're serving or you're not sure what the right term is or what the best practice is, you know, the best idea is to try to be as specific as you can. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in the coming slides. So, again, there's some universal things you can do that will make everybody feel welcome. But then if you're trying to provide some very specific accommodations, you want to be as specific as possible when you're referring to folks or the services. And the kind of general definition that is used here at DPI for public libraries when we're talking about who are special populations and what are special services, the phrase we use is folks for whom using the library is difficult or for whom using the library is limited or minimized in some way. And those that terminology has stems from the LSTA grants, because a lot of our projects related to accessibility, or formerly known as special needs, stems from LSTA grants. So that's kind of one of the definitions we're using today, because it's recognizable for many of the folks joining us. And so this is just an exercise here, and you can put your thoughts into the chat if you have any on with this group here. These might be folks using your library, these adults, but if you can just identify the special need that's addressed with this group of patrons. So if you can just put something in the chat of identifying the special need. So we'll pause for just a moment as you put your thoughts in the chat. I'm sensing a little shyness here, or perhaps you're just really looking closely at your screen, or you just have caught on to the exercise knowing that, you know, As Therese says here, it could be all or none. Special needs are often invisible, and that's very true. There are a lot of things that you might be able to guess or suspect based on, you know, the appearance of the folks you're serving, but you might not ever be able to tell, and so that can be really tricky, and that's something we want to acknowledge and just say, you know, we all are trying to do our best and to learn more, but, you know, a lot of things we might never know, or we might not know until we're asking more questions or learning a little bit more about who's in the group. So for those of you who have some ideas, those are absolutely great, and we have no idea if any of those are perhaps needs or attributes to this group here. But I think that you offered some great ideas, so thanks for participating in that exercise. Another set of terms that we use here at DPI, again, primarily for the LSPA grants, but these are some identified special populations, and some of these might be really familiar to you in the community that you serve or that your system serves. These are groups that, again, we are using for some Wisconsin grants, but these are also terms that come from other states and from the federal level that are generally recognizable. But you'll see that at the bottom of the list there's a question mark, because this is not this is not a definite list. These aren't the only populations we're talking about. So if it's not on the list, you know, you don't deserve attention. That's not the case. And in fact, I would say that with most of my consulting with libraries, a lot of libraries have their own unique populations that they're trying to serve. Some that might need accommodations, and some just might need a simple recognition or awareness that they are part of the total population that you're serving. So just know that these are some of the examples, and you'll see from the list that people with disabilities are included on here, but again, there are many more than that, and often some of these descriptions, you will not be able to recognize folks from these groups just by their appearance. So again, just some broadening of awareness of populations and what their needs might be. So in speaking about services, in particular special services as we call them, there are a couple different features here, and again, this is not an exhaustive list, but just some things to think about for our conversation today. And so I'm going to walk through these, again, for folks who are perhaps joining us later with the recording. I don't always like to read directly what the screen says, but in this case, I want to make it a learning experience that works for everyone. So again, services just might be increasing the awareness of what your library offers. Again, thinking about, is your library a welcoming place? Do you have to physically go to your library to know that those services are available? If they're not known or communicated outside of the library, then it's difficult, especially if people have limited or minimized use of the library, to make the effort to take advantage of those services. For example, if you are connected to a literacy network and there's tutoring that happens on site at your library, well, that's something for folks who have limited literacy skills, that's something that there might need to be more awareness made of that. Also, one big thing I hear a lot, especially for grants, is just awareness of what is needed. And I think this is probably the hardest thing to do at a system level and in library level, is how do you know who you're not serving if they're not coming in? And how do you know the different obstacles that might be preventing folks from coming in? One I know is an issue, especially for families living in poverty, is transportation. If it's not part of the school day, then it's often really hard for families to take part in something at the library, especially if it's in the evening or on the weekend. So that's an example of another kind of service the library might consider looking into. And then even just simple welcoming efforts. We know that there are different kinds of learning, different ways that people access information. So this could be something as simple as, you know, having a video on your website, perhaps with that's translated or has the closed captioning so that people can read the text as well as hear it, to to understand how to do simple library procedures like placing a hold or using a Dropbox or things that might not be as familiar to everybody. Other things such as accommodations, that making sure that they don't require a huge amount of effort to know that they're even available or to take advantage of them. For example, if you have alternative borrowing privileges, if somebody, if it's not clear on any of your signage or on your application form or, you know, anywhere that you, there's an option for having a limited use card where you can only check out one thing at a time, or you have a guest pass for using the library computers if you don't have your own library card or you're uncomfortable sharing your name. I mean, things like that, people shouldn't have to, you know, dig really deep to find those. That should be really visible. And then something that some libraries do really, really well and others want to do, but it requires time, staff, and money, are our outreach efforts. And these can be really kind of passive things or more active efforts. And, you know, there's a range of things from off-site visits and programming to things that are more static, like book bins at a homeless shelter. So these are just some examples of things that libraries and systems can do or consider to kind of get us thinking a little bit broadly about our topic today. And then I'm going to go on to thinking about spaces, and these kind of extend from some of the services aspects I just discussed. But again, a lot of it is this visibility factor, especially if you're somebody who is less experienced with the library, your use is minimized or compromised in some way. You might not feel totally comfortable asking or even know what to ask about spaces or services or any other features of your library. So making it very visible helps both the folks who might need some of those accommodations or just to all patrons that this is something your library is supporting. So, you know, it could be bilingual signage around your library. Even if you don't speak that language, you might just recognize what language it's in and know that your library is doing a better job at trying to communicate to all the people in your community. That's something that you can consider. Also, it's just sometimes the language we use in speaking to our patrons. For example, often in youth programming, it's very easy just to refer to the adults with the children as parents. Many of them often are the parents, but there are grandparents and guardians and different caregivers. So you don't always know the relationship. I mean, you can make assumptions. Sometimes it's not what you think. I often take my nieces and nephew to story time. Sometimes I'm considered the nanny or the mom or the aunt. I mean, and it's not about feeling overwhelmed by being politically correct. It's just being more welcoming by saying families or giving a lot of examples rather than just one as the assumption of this is who should be here. So that's again, another way to recognize different users. Also, and I'm glad to see that Bradley is joining us today because she gave me the example here for setting the tone. And again, this is kind of awareness to both folks who might need some of these special services or space accommodations or letting folks who might not even know that they're available, might not need them, but maybe just knowing that the library provides them is important. For example, at OWLD, in their facility that they have as hearing loops, they make it a point that any speaker will use the equipment that they have for that, and they explain how it works so that even if you're not a person who is accessing the session or the room using the hearing loops, you're aware that it's available and more aware that this is a feature that is needed. So that's a really great thing to do. Again, kind of that universal, this benefits everybody. Also, just a message that you might be sending as part of a community player by having, whether it's a collection bin or signage or co-hosting, different things happening in the community that support some of these special populations. That's another way to kind of set the tone or show how your library is trying to make a stronger connection with your entire community, not just the people who always use the library. Also, informational and invitational signing. For example, having reserved seating if you're having a session and you're not sure, but perhaps there might be folks who, just like at the airport when you're lining up for boarding, when they just make a general announcement, if you need a little bit more time or you have equipment that needs more space, or you know, whether it's a stroller or a walker or a wheelchair, those folks are allowed to board first. The same thing you could have in your setting up for a program. You don't know if somebody's going to come, but you might make an aisle or block up a certain set for folks who might need to be sitting closer or have more space around them. Also, like I described in a little earlier, making clear like some things you don't necessarily need to have a card, a library card, to use. If you have, you know, if you have free books or if you have guest passes or things like that. If you have somebody who has some special concerns or is unsure about something, that's often a great place to start, especially if they, just, again, aren't sure of what to even ask for because they have some hesitations or some minimal or limited use at the library or past experiences. These are just some things to consider, and sometimes it's hard to think of these things when we're in the libraries day in and day out, and to us it's so obvious. But again, kind of walking through your library as though you've never been there before, or you you speak a different language, or you have limited literacy needs, or you have a learning disability, or some of these populations we've described. Kind of walking through your library and looking at the signage or the handouts or what's on your website, and just kind of having a little bit greater awareness of that. So before we switch into learning about universal design, universal design for learning, Jolene and I kind of wanted to set up some possible library patrons here for us to think about as we learn about this new framework and how this framework might apply to these particular imaginary patrons. So, you can read the description here about each of them. So this is Pia, a young girl, and she is somebody who may be using the library, but certainly could be a great reader, but has some family situations that might make library use a little bit compromised. We don't know exactly, and again, we can all make our different inferences based on these brief descriptions here. This is just meant to be an exercise both for us individually and as a group in our webinar today. So just some things to think about here as we move forward. So this is Pia. And then we also have Larry. Now he is somebody who is a potential great library user, perpetually curious, lifelong learner. But Larry has some perhaps transportation needs, perhaps has some different learning needs that might be considered by your library. So this is somebody else we'd like you to be thinking about in the back of your mind. And then we have Anna. Now, Anna is shown here with her son because she really wants the best for him, and he is kind of the priority in what she does. Now, she is somebody who doesn't have a typical housing situation, but you might not know that. And you might not know what her concerns about privacy are, but how does your perhaps signage communicate things where she might not need to ask? So this is another patron that, again, we don't know the backstory, but it's something we might consider with some of the things we're talking about today. And our last pretend patron is Jay. Jay is a teenager, again, somebody who may or may not be taking advantage of library programs and services, but certainly someone who has a lot of energy and could be making a lot of great connections, and you just don't know his whole story. And from the way he behaves at the library, you might wonder if something else is going on, or if he's just an animated kid who is seeking some stronger connections. You really just might not know the whole story, but he's somebody we want you to be thinking about as we go on today. So these are our four. I'm going to walk back through them quickly. So we've got Pia, Larry, Anna, and Jay. So be thinking about those four as we move on to learning about a framework that might have connections to public libraries, universal design and universal design for learning. So I'm going to turn it over to you, Jolene.
Great. Thank you, Tessa. You've certainly given us a lot to think about today, and I'm going to hopefully give you some more to think about here as we talk about universal design and then universal design for learning. I want to start with universal design. Universal design is the design of products and environments to be usable by all people to the greatest extent possible without the need for adaptation or specialized design. And this concept was coined by Ron Mace back in the 1970s, and he was an architect at North Carolina State University. And the intent behind universal design is to simplify life for everyone by making products, communications, and the environment more usable by as many people as possible. Universal design benefits people of all ages and abilities. So we think about things like curb cutouts that are put into sidewalks, and certainly those are designed for people in wheelchairs, but they have these unexpected benefits for the greater population. So they benefit all of us on a daily basis, whether we're riding our bike or pushing a stroller or we're pulling our rolling luggage behind at the airport. We all benefit from things like curb cutouts, and we start actually to really kind of take those things for granted. They're built in, they're there, and we don't really stop to think about the origin. Another example is closed captioning. Again, closed captioning was designed for people with hearing impairments, but it's become such a great benefit to the entire population that it's something we use all the time and we don't really even stop to think about it. So we use it at the health club if we're working out. We use it if we're out to dinner or at a sports bar having a drink with some friends. We use it at the airport. We use it all the time. We use it at home if we're trying to watch one of the popular British television shows like Downton Abbey and we don't want to miss anything. So we're really using this feature that was not really originally designed for us, but we're using it all the time. The number one use of closed captioning in the United States is not at all for people with hearing impairments. The number one use of closed captioning in the United States is actually couples in bed, where one partner would like to continue to watch TV and one partner would like to go to sleep. So again, you see the idea here is building in features that can really benefit everyone. So Ron Mace, again, said to consider the needs of the broadest possible range of users from the beginning, and if you design for those in the margins, it works better for everyone. So there are seven principles of universal design, and I by no means am an expert in universal design, but I will walk us through these principles. Here, the first is equitable use. So the design is useful and marketable to people with diverse abilities. The second is flexibility in use. So the design accommodates a wide range of individual preferences and abilities. The third is simple and intuitive. So the use of the design is very easy to understand, regardless of the user's experience, knowledge, language skills, cognitive level, etc. The fourth is perceptible information. So the design communicates necessary information effectively to the user regardless of their sensory abilities, so regardless of things like their vision or their hearing. The fifth is tolerance for error. So the design minimizes hazards and the adverse consequences of accidental or unintended actions. Number six is low physical effort. So the design can be used efficiently and comfortably with a minimum of fatigue. And the last principle of universal design, number seven, is the size and space for approach and use. So the design has the appropriate size and space for approach, for reach, for manipulation, and for use, regardless of the user's body size, position, or mobility. There are other similar concepts out there. So you might hear phrases like barrier-free design, or inclusive design, or design for all. They're all very similar. But universal design really is what led then to the framework of universal design for learning. So that's our focus for today. So universal design for learning takes this concept of universal design in architecture and really applies it to the world of instruction. So universal design for learning is defined in Wisconsin as a scientifically valid framework that provides multiple means of access, assessment, and engagement, and removes barriers in instruction to achieve academic and behavioral success for all. So universal design for learning was developed then to reduce barriers in instruction. So just like there are barriers in our physical environment, like a building that only has a set of stairs for access, there can also be barriers in our educational or instructional world. So one that quickly comes to mind is text. Text can be a barrier for a lot of individuals, whether they have a vision impairment, or they're acquiring the English language, or they have a learning disability, or maybe they're physically unable to turn the pages of a book. So the framework of universal design for learning was put into place to try to reduce these instructional barriers. And it really was developed then to meet the wide range of needs of all learners. And it's based on the idea that a one-size-fits-all approach to instruction is not effective. And again, the inspiration came from that concept of universal design in architecture. So universal design for learning is based on modern brain research, modern neurocognitive research that tells us that the way we learn is as unique as our fingerprints. So with the technology that we have today to look at our brains during learning tasks, we're able to identify that no two people learn a task or approach a learning task in exactly the same way. So therefore, we have the three principles of universal design for learning that really take into account the idea that we need to use multiple ways to reach all learners. So the first principle of universal design for learning is to provide multiple means of representation. And we kind of think of this as the access piece. So providing information and content in multiple ways so that as many users as possible can access it. The second principle of universal design for learning is to provide multiple means of action and expression. And in education, we think of this kind of as the assessment piece. So providing multiple ways for individuals to show that the learning has occurred. And the third principle of universal design for learning is to provide multiple means of engagement. So really recognizing that there's this strong variability between individuals in what motivates them, what keeps their interest, what gets their interest. So that idea of providing multiple means of engagement. So here's a little comparison then to help us think about these two frameworks. Universal design really is looking at the physical environment and what physical barriers might exist in our architectural or physical environment. And it is the proactive design of the physical space to help meet the needs of everyone. And we look at universal design because physical retrofitting after the fact can be very costly and often is inelegant or can be kind of an eyesore. So if a ramp has to be added to a building after the fact, it's very unlikely that it's going to fit in with the flow and style of that building. the same features that apply to Universal Design for Learning, just really looking at the instructional environment and looking at what learning barriers may exist in our curricular or instructional environment. And Universal Design for Learning then is the proactive design of our curriculum and instruction. And we do this because instructional accommodations done after the fact are very time consuming and often are very difficult to implement. So, some things for public libraries to consider. Public libraries really need to think about both universal design, the physical space and environment, as well as universal design for learning, the instructional side of things. So public libraries should carefully consider the learning and information needs of all the members of their community. And they need to think about both the physical and intellectual access to information. And really then design and deliver library programs that include multiple representations of the same information, so multiple ways for individuals to access the information. And when designing your spaces and your services, really start to think about learners in a variety of ways, thinking about their auditory, their visual, and hands-on means that they may need to access all of your library spaces and services. So a few other resources and things that I feel public libraries should be aware of and familiar with, and I'm sure many of you are aware of these things, but first of all, just to point out that there are many accessibility features, both for Windows and Mac, so when you have workstations for patrons or even for your own staff, thinking about some features that are free and are either built into the system or that you can download. There's things like magnifiers. There are things like on-screen keyboards that have text prediction. There are things like inverted colors or high contrast. There are different alternatives to sound. So for a screen alert, it could be a screen flash or things like that. There are ways to change the color and the size of the mouse pointer. So all kinds of built-in accessibility features that can just be really beneficial to the greater population. And another thing that hopefully you're aware of, but perhaps you're not, is a service called Bookshare. And Bookshare is an online accessible library for individuals with print disabilities. And by print disabilities, we're talking about a variety of patrons, perhaps with a vision impairment, perhaps with a learning disability, or just someone who's unable to physically turn the pages of a book. Bookshare is a way for individuals to obtain accessible books in a variety of formats. So they have formats like Braille, MP3 files, ebooks, all kinds of different formats available that can be used then with a variety of devices like an iPad or a smartphone or a PC. And Bookshare actually has over 230,000 titles, and not just books, but they have things like newspapers and magazines. And Bookshare is available to any student with a qualifying print disability. For free, they can have a free membership, and that's through a grant from the Office of Special Education at the federal level. And that includes K-12, both public and private schools, as well as homeschool students and post-secondary students, private and public. It is also available to anyone with a qualifying print disability if they are not a student for a small fee. It's an annual fee of $50 a year, although the first time that a user sets up an account, there's a $25 setup fee. But that's just something really to be aware of, and because you may have patrons that could really benefit from a service like that. And then finally, I've included on this slide just a couple of resources specific to libraries and looking at the ADA guidelines and just thinking about accessibility in that way. Okay, so we want to kind of go back to our four individuals that we had talked about earlier and have a little bit of discussion now that you know a little bit about both universal design and universal design for learning, and you have a little bit broader awareness about ways to just make your library spaces and services more friendly and welcoming for all.
So what we're going to do right now, and again, we know that today's presentation, like I said, was informative and explorative. Nobody's supposed to be an instant expert after 48 minutes of learning about this. But again, we want to take advantage of we're all trying to figure this out in different ways together. And so what I'm going to ask you to do, and don't be shy, is in the chat, any ideas that come to your mind right now for this pretend patron Pia, things that you come to your head for the ways that the space might be more welcoming and accessible, different ways that she or her family might engage with library services or programs. Any thoughts that you have, if this was one of your patrons, how might you proactively try to accommodate her and her family? So I realize that there is a little bit of delay from when you hear our voices and our thinking and entering it into the chat, but we want to have time for this exercise, so we will kind of pause for a moment as you go to the chat, and any thoughts you have or questions that come up that would that come to your mind as you think, what do you do when this this patron is using your library and what you might do? And again, we're going to ask you to use the chat to share your thoughts on this. So if you can enter that, that would be beneficial. Thanks, Leah, for your suggestion that just came in, having a bilingual card application. This is something that can have huge benefits, especially, and I'm not suggesting this is the case of Pia or her family, but who might be unfamiliar with what is required of the library. We know that especially for folks who are coming from communities or nations where library use is not the same as it is in the U.S., they may be unfamiliar with how the library works or may be unsure of libraries as government institutions. So there can be hesitation there. Is there a cost? What are they going to do with my information? Those are kinds of things that if it's all spelled out in a bilingual card application, that would be a great way that people don't have to ask those difficult questions. It's just right there for them. Thank you, Brian, for understanding that a child might be shy and that you might need to have a conversation to kind of pull out some of the needs that you might be able to address. And Marcia, making a connection to schools is so important, especially for child who might be able to then access access the computer at home, show her folks what they learned at school, and maybe see that library card application, see a video with the messages about the library that are perhaps with the captioning or translated as well. Those are ways to make that school connection, which is often a trusted place for families, how to pass that trust from the school to the library. That's a great idea. Well, thank you for these brave folks who put ideas out there. Again, we're all just kind of thinking off the top of our heads here based on the conversation we're having right now. I'm going to move on to the next patron, but certainly if you have another idea that comes to you, the perfect Pia solution, don't be shy about putting it up there. But let's think for a moment about Larry. What might you do for Larry if he were a patron at your library, or you had lots of patrons like Larry at a couple libraries in your system? What are some things that you might do? I, for one, can share that I worked in a public library that had a lot of patrons like Larry, and we had limited staff and time and money, so we had to figure out, like Sean is saying, how to have drop-in computer help with no registration required, making it really clear that there are different ways to access help where there's no judgment. You might not even know what you want to ask, but there's somebody who is there who is willing to help you and not looking over your shoulder at the other people in line, or having a really clear sign-up way, as Sarah's suggesting, for, you know, here's what we have for you, here are different ways to access this, signing up. Those are great suggestions. I think sometimes having an FAQ, whether it's, again, a little video tutorial or having it online, again, that thing that maybe has often happened for me where I have the adult children saying, I really need this to take home to Dad. I've been telling him about this, but he, you know, he's not taking my word for it. If you have, again, a handout that might be printed in a little bit larger type or have some visuals on there, so that folks know when they come in, they know exactly what to ask for or who to look for or what it's going to be like. Those can be just small efforts to be a little bit more welcoming. Thanks, Sean and Sarah, for those suggestions. We're now going to move on to Anna. And again, Anna's situation is one that you really might not know that much about. But again, I think it's that awareness that there are always people in our community who are having some struggles or have goals that might not be that evident to us that we can be sensitive about in a very welcoming, universal way. So I think one of the suggestions that already came up was having different ways to access library services, whether it's using the public computers or you know, having a guest pass to do that, or having computers like an express computer that anyone can use for a short amount of time. That's something where, you know, somebody who is not comfortable sharing their information at that time, you know, can still take advantage of public resources. So we've got a couple other suggestions here for different ways that Anna and the needs of Anna and her son might be accommodated. Having, you know, I think this is something we're seeing a lot of places where parents can be doing their thing while their child is having a different library experience, but within vicinity, whether it's a laptop in a program room or just a special computer room for families. Those are great suggestions. And again, making it really clear that this is intended purpose rather than, oh, well, that room looks empty, but nobody's in there and there are no signs. I really don't feel comfortable plunking down with my laptop and having my son over there on his Game Boy if that's not what we're supposed to be doing, especially if you're afraid that somebody might come and ask you where your library card is or something like that. I mean, I think in general, library staff are incredibly friendly. But again, we don't always know where people are coming from. So making it really, really clear that what the many different ways that people can engage with space or services is important. We just have one more before we open it up to general questions, and that is Jay. Again, we might not be able to tell all these things about Jay from our interactions with him. So again, you might not know the full story. But how might you respond if you had a teen like Jay who is using your library, popping in, sometimes breaking some rules, but, you know, generally a really nice, friendly, energetic kid? How would you connect with Jay at your library? I'm seeing some folks chatting, so we'll give a moment as those show up. I know that one thing that a lot of libraries try to do for teens is to really make sure behavior guidelines are visible and clear and not as this big poster of rules, but just how that they are being considered as adults and responsible users of the library, having that just really clear. Sarah makes a great point of trying to tap into that energy, especially if you see somebody who perhaps maybe is a little lonely or having a hard time connecting with their peers for whatever reason, personality or just maybe has a learning issue or something else that is making it really hard to stay as part of a team group or something like that. You know, tapping into that to say, I know if you're reading a lot of nonfiction, would you be interested in helping be a nonfiction shelver, or you're really good at with physical tasks, would you be willing to help with hanging your artwork, or, you know, different things like that. Absolutely is a great suggestion. And absolutely, Leah, your response of greeting him in a friendly way when he arrives, I mean, that is the number one thing, is trying to greet everybody with a smile and a welcome and not waiting to see what they might need, but just asking, how can we help you, or glad to see you here. Do you know about our, gummy sushi party this afternoon? Is that something you might want to be part of? Letting him know that, exactly as Joe said, that you see him and you want to engage with him, and that you value him at the library and want to make connections. Those are great suggestions. And again, not all of these require any kind of funding. It's, again, more of that awareness of there are many different ways to connect. And sometimes it's just sitting back and looking at what do we have and what might we need to tweak. So thank you for your suggestions on that. Again, we realize it's on the fly, and that there's people are a little unsure and not wanting to offend or do the wrong thing, but there are many, many simple right things to do. I know we just have a few moments left on here, and that hopefully a lot of you are thinking and taking ideas back to your work lives. But if there are any other questions or comments, we'd love to see those in the chat in our final moments together here today. Certainly, both Jolene and I are available for any other follow-up after today's webinar over the phone or email. But please let us know your thoughts in the chat, even if you're just signing off and, you know, enjoy today's session. We would appreciate that feedback or other topics you would hope that we can address in the future. Throw those thoughts up there as well.
Great. Thank you, everyone. And it's been a privilege and an honor to be here with Tessa today, and I hope that you got some takeaways out of this.
Thank you very much, Jolene. I really valued the framework that you brought for understanding universal design and universal design for learning. I think there's a lot of good stuff here to think about, and certainly I'll be bringing to future discussions that I have. So thank you all for your time. We're going to close up today's webinar. Again, please be in touch as needed. Thank you.